Hey everyone, welcome back to Catholicism. Wow, this is part four in my series rebutting Pastor Jeff Durbin's Is Protestantism Heresy series. We've already seen Pastor Jeff fall flat on his face in regards to the Holy Mother, the Blessed Sacrament, the Pope, and now he's going to try and convince us of Sola Scriptura. So let's see what Pastor Jeff has to say for himself today.
My experience most commonly with Roman Catholics is they don't understand what Christians mean or Protestants mean when we say Sola Scriptura, that Scripture is the sole infallible rule of faith and practice, that it is the reference point because it is divinely inspired. We don't have any problem with healthy and good and spiritually consistent traditions and practices so long as they're consistent with the Word of God. The more important thing to do is actually to go to the words of inspired Scripture to say, does the Bible teach this position?
The reason why Catholics have, in your opinion, a distorted opinion or a distorted view of Sola Scriptura is, as you can see from the clip that I showed from Pastor Jeff's video on the Pope in this series, Protestants have a sliding scale on what Sola Scriptura actually means. If they come across a Catholic tradition that they don't like, the first thing they say is, well, where is that taught in the Bible? And then when you point out to them, well, where is Sola Scriptura taught in the Bible? Then it becomes, well, it doesn't have to be taught in the Bible because it's the only infallible rule. You can have other rules of faith, but the Bible is the only infallible rule. It's a heads I win, tails you lose proposition. That's all. It's Protestants just being, you know, in case A, I'm right, in case B, I'm right. If you judge traditions by the scriptures and your only standard is in order for this tradition to be valid, it can't contradict the scripture, every Catholic tradition is valid. No Catholic tradition contradicts the scripture properly understood, not one. Now, Catholic traditions don't have to measure up to your erroneous interpretation of the scripture. And that's why we have a magisterium. That's why we have an authoritative church. That's why we have a church that can settle disputes exactly as Jesus prescribed to have disputes settled.
For example, our church is a 1689 London Baptist Confession of Faith church. Some of my best friends hold to the Westminster Confession of Faith. That's a tradition. That's not scripture, but it's a tradition that is defining faith and practice from a biblical perspective, and that tradition itself is not running alongside the Bible as a standard like the Bible. It is essentially expressing what the Bible teaches about these things, but it's subordinate to scripture and to be ultimately held to account by the Word of God.
The problem with that is that the Bible didn't just fall out of the sky. God didn't reach down and hand the scriptures to St. Peter or St. Paul or St. Irenaeus. He didn't just hand the scriptures to anybody and say, here, this is your Bible. No, there were many, 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 many writings at the time, some apostolic, some claiming to be apostolic that weren't, some from students of the apostles, direct people who directly learned from the apostles. And the church sifted through all of that and under the guidance of the Holy Spirit decided what was inspired and what was not. You cannot have a Bible if you do not have an authoritative and infallible church to tell you what the Bible is, because then at best, you have a fallible collection of infallible books. And if the collection is fallible, how do you know all of the infallible books are in there? How do you know all the books that are in there are infallible? You can't have an infallible Bible unless you have an infallible church that gives that infallible Bible legitimacy. You have to have a church that's trustworthy all the time, without doubt. You have to have that. It only makes sense. It doesn't make sense to not have that. And if the church isn't infallible, then how do you trust their judgment when it comes to disputes? You know, there are so many things, there are so many infallible teachings of the Catholic Church that you accept. You accept the Bible. That's an infallible teaching of the Catholic Church. You accept the Trinity. That's an infallible teaching of the Catholic Church. Without an infallible church, the Bible can mean whatever anyone wants it to mean. Because you don't have an infallible authority outside of the Bible to say, hold on now. That's not what that says.
2 Thessalonians 2:15. And that text says, he's talking about, I'll start in verse 13. But we ought to always give thanks, to God for you, brothers, beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as the first fruits to be saved through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth. So we're talking about the gospel here. To this he called you through our gospel so that you may obtain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, brothers, stand firm and hold to the traditions that were taught by us, either by spoken word or by letter. Now, this is written at a time where the canon is not closed. The apostles are still preaching. The apostles are still teaching. We're getting inspired scripture as we are right here. But the apostles aren't dead yet. The canon isn't closed yet. These inspired apostles are still living among them and giving inspired literature. And yes, the Christian church was handed, Christian faith was handed down via creed and confession and teaching by the mouth and by inspired revelation from the apostles. Yes, and amen to that. But this does not teach that the church has the ability to take any tradition that rises up and to hold somebody to it as though it were inspired tradition. How do you and I know today, with the closing of the Christian canon and the death of the inspired writers, how do we know today what the Word of God is? And answer is only by scripture, only what has been handed down via scripture, the written revelation of God.
And that brings us back to, where does the Bible say that? So we have the Bible saying, hold fast to the lessons, to the traditions that we taught you, whether by word of mouth or by letter. So we have the Bible saying, hold fast to tradition, whether it's written or oral. It's all the Word of God. We have the Bible saying that. You just read it. So now you have to show me where the Bible says until the last apostle is dead, and then only what was written down matters. That's your burden. If that's going to be your argument, then your burden has to be, where is that in the Bible? Where does the Bible say oral tradition matters until it's all written down? And you also have to show that it has all been written down.
It is the standard, by the way, that even the early Jews were to hold to in terms of, these are the inspired writings. Yes, they had their traditions, and yeah, I'm going to go to this in a minute. They actually held to those traditions in a very erroneous way and sinful way, ultimately, defying the words of God. But they knew what their scriptures were. These are the writings of the prophets, and these are our traditions, right? They had that problem as well, but they knew what their scriptures were. They were entrusted with the oracles of God, Paul says in Romans chapter 3. They knew what their Bible was. They knew what the inspired revelation was, over against what their traditions were. They knew what that was. It was laid up in the second temple. There's no confusion there.
No. The Jews had an authoritative magisterium, and Jesus even affirmed their authority in Matthew 23, verses 2 and 3. Jesus says, "The scribes and Pharisees sit on Moses' seat, so practice and observe whatever they tell you. but do not do what they do, for they preach, but do not practice. This is exactly what we see with the Catholic Magisterium. The Pope sits on the seat of St. Peter, and we must be obedient to everything that he teaches from that seat. Now, if the Pope happens to be in error, we are not to follow him into that error. However, we do still have to give religious assent of mind and will to whatever he teaches in his official magisterium from the chair of St. Peter. We also see in the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 13, verses 17, the author writes, "Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls as men who will have to give account. Let them do this joyfully and not sadly, for that would be of no advantage to you." The church is authoritative. The church has authority that the New Testament and Jesus say that we need to obey. We don't get to just pick and choose what teachings we want to follow.
And in this case, yes, the apostles were teaching orally and they were giving things in writing. And Paul tells them to hold to these traditions. But what is he talking about? He's talking about the gospel. He's talking about the gospel here. There's nothing here about issues of traditions like Mary and the other dogmas of the Roman Catholic Church. He's talking about the gospel, and they're to hold to these traditions either by spoken word or by letter. Nothing in here saying that tradition is to be elevated to the status of scripture-inspired writings, because here's the thing, you're going to have a real problem as a Roman Catholic if you believe that. A, there are Roman Catholic traditions today that are being forced upon Roman Catholic hearts and minds that you must do this to be faithful that you do not even find in the early church. You will not find it in the church.
Name one. You can find the sinlessness of Mary in the early church. You can find the perpetual virginity of Mary in the early church. You can find the assumption of Mary in the church, in the early church. And I'm talking the late first century, very early second century early church. Within living memory of the apostles, you can find these things. You can find the Eucharist as a sacrifice. You can find the real presence of the Eucharist. You can find infant baptism. You can find sprinkling as opposed to immersion. Yes, immersion is preferred. And immersion in living water is what is preferred. However, the Didache clearly says that sprinkling is fine. There are no Catholic dogmas that you cannot find in the early church. That's just a lie.
To which Roman Catholic apologists today will even admit, yeah, it was always there. It just wasn't revealed yet. Like, it's only been revealed now. It sort of pops up now, today, or near us in time, and you can't find it in church history. It's like pulling a rabbit out of a hat.
Just because something wasn't dogmatically defined until relatively recently doesn't mean that it wasn't believed before that, or even as far back as the apostles. Saint Epiphanius wrote about the Blessed Virgin's Assumption. He wrote, "Like the bodies of the saints, however, she has been held in honor for her character and understanding. And if I should say anything more in her praise, she is like Elijah, who was virgin from his mother's womb, always remained so, and was taken up, but has not seen death." The Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary wasn't dogmatically defined until 1950 because there wasn't a reason for it to be. It wasn't in dispute. The Catholic Church only dogmatically defines things to settle disputes or to stamp out heresy. The reason why this was defined by Pope Pius XII in 1950 wasn't because it was disputed, wasn't because there was a heresy. It was merely because it was a very, very old tradition and there was public outcry within the church to dogmatically define it. And so it was in 1950, but it was taught hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years before that.
And so that's the first issue. You'll have that problem. But You also have the problem of the fact that Roman Catholic traditions so clearly violate and contradict what the inspired apostles said themselves. And here's what I mean by that. And I'll just try to go quickly on this point, because we have lots of teaching online about this. If you look at Matthew chapter 15, you see a phenomenal example of how the Lord Jesus deals with what were considered divine traditions of his day. And in Matthew chapter 15, something comes up that is very, very important. And Matthew chapter 15, something comes up called the Korban rule. And in the Korban rule, this was seen as a tradition that went all the way back to Moses. So they knew what their Bible was, their inspired writings, what the prophets and apostles, the prophets had taught, and the Torah, the Psalms, all those. They knew what those were. As I said, Romans chapter 3, the Apostle Paul says they were entrusted with the very oracles of God. They knew what those were, but they also had divine traditions that they would claim went all the way back to Moses. I'm not going to give an entire lesson today on Sola Scriptura, but just to show you Jesus actually teaching the principle of Sola Scriptura. In Matthew 15, it says, "Then Pharisees and scribes came to Jesus from Jerusalem and said, 'Why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders, for they do not wash their hands when they eat?' He answered them, 'And why do you break the commandment of God for the sake of your tradition? For God commanded, honor your father and your mother. And whoever reviles father or mother must surely die. But you say, if anyone tells his father or his mother, what you would have gained from me is given to God. He need not honor his father. So for the sake of your tradition, you have made void the word of God.'" So Jesus takes what they thought was a divine tradition in terms of the Korban rule, and, you know, they're supposed to care for their aging parents, supposed to take care of them, but they gave that money to the temple, so they gave it to a holy thing, and now they're leaving their parents behind, and Jesus is saying, basically, you're violating God's law through what you say. You say this, Moses said this. So what is it? It's in Jesus' day, a parallel to the situation that we have with Rome today. They claim divinely inspired traditions that run alongside the written word of God, and they say that it is these two things that work together, scripture and tradition. This is divine tradition. You must accept it as well. Well, when Jesus was dealing with that in his day with the Jews, same situation, inspired revelation of God, and you've got this divine tradition coming alongside of it. Jesus said this, "You say this, your tradition says this, but God says this." So he says, "Thus, you invalidate the word of God. You make void the word of God for the sake of your tradition." Jesus believed that you could take the word of God and you can compare it to so-called divine traditions, and you could see that this divine tradition actually contradicts the word of God and therefore makes void the word of God. So I want to hold to the position Jesus held to. He's the divine Son of God. He's the incarnate one. I want to do what he did. And when the incarnate one comes and walks among us, when he's confronted with divine traditions in his day, what does he do? He tests them by the scriptures.
The Korban rule, in and of itself, was not a bad tradition. It simply was a way for people to dedicate a portion of their estate to the church. However, the practice in Jesus's time was very much being abused. The church was collaborating with people to squirrel away money that should have been used to take care of their aging parents. This is what violated the scriptures. This is what violated the Ten Commandments when it says to honor your father and mother. A good parallel of this in the Catholic Church would be the selling of indulgences. Indulgences in and of themselves aren't bad. And even the exchange of an indulgence or the meriting of an indulgence through almsgiving isn't necessarily bad. But we did see around the Renaissance, this practice was being abused. It was being abused for simony, and it was being abused to raise money for the church through illicit and immoral means. And just like Jesus put a stop to the Korban rule, the Catholic Church at the Council of Trent put a stop to the exchange of indulgences for almsgiving because it was a practice that was being corrupted. So once again, Christ's authoritative church self-corrected and remained on the correct course. And again, Pastor Jeff's claim is that Catholic doctrines or Catholic traditions run counter to the Bible. He hasn't shown this.
This has been the standard throughout redemptive history. It is the revelation of God, the inspired revelation of God, that is supposed to be the standard. Whether it's in Isaiah 8:20, to the law and to the testimony, if they do not speak according to this word, it is because they have no light in them. Whether it's Deuteronomy 13, and a prophet comes and has signs and wonders, if they contradict God's previous revelation, they're a false prophet.
Going by your reading of Deuteronomy chapter 13, every single one of the apostles was a false prophet because they all taught things that were counter to what God had revealed prior in the Old Testament. They taught that you didn't have to be circumcised. They taught that you could eat meat sacrificed to idols. They taught that you could eat things that had previously been considered unclean. So by your standard, by your reading of Deuteronomy chapter 13, and by your Sola Scriptura standard, every single one of Jesus' apostles was a false prophet. You don't get to have it both ways, Pastor Jeff.
Whatever the case may be in redemptive history, you always see that principle running. It is the revelation of God, the inspired revelation of God, that is the reference point and standard. Jesus says, John 17:17, thy word is truth. It's the plumb line. It's the reference point to see if something is right or true. You hold it alongside of it to see, is it true? Jesus said that about the word of God. His word is truth. It's the reference point. You see that throughout redemptive history, the word of God being the standard. And yes, of course, you can even show instances in church history from the text where, for example, in the book of Acts, you had the Berean Christians who were more noble-minded than the ones in Thessalonica, because when they heard Paul preaching, what did they do? They searched the scriptures daily to see if what Paul was saying was the truth. In other words, you had these early Christians given a compliment in scripture because they actually tested the words of an inspired apostle. Imagine that. The apostle Paul, an inspired apostle, preaching and teaching, and Christians in that day going, let's see. Is what he's saying true? Why? Well, that wouldn't have been offensive to Paul, because God's revelation is the reference point, right? And you're to be tested. That's the point. And so we could do a whole thing on this, but I think that'll suffice for now.
This single verse is often used by Protestants to support the idea of sola scriptura. They would have you believe that the Jews in Thessalonica just rejected Paul because reasons, but the Jews in Berea actually read the Bible and understood what he was talking about. But that's not what happened at all. Let's take a look at what actually happened in Thessalonica as recorded in Acts chapter 17. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul went in, as was his custom, and for 3 weeks he argued with them from the scriptures, explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead, and saying, this Jesus, whom I proclaim to you, is the Christ. And some of them were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, and did a great many of the devout Greeks, and not a few of the leading women. But the Jews were jealous, and taking some wicked fellows of the rabble, they gathered a crowd, set the city in an uproar, and attacked the house of Jason, seeking to bring them out to the people. And when they could not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the brethren before the city authorities, crying, these men who have turned the world upside down have come here also. And Jason has received them, and they are all acting against the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, Jesus. And the people and the city authorities were disturbed when they heard this. And when they had taken security from Jason and the rest, they let them go. So as you can see, it isn't that the Jews in Thessalonica didn't look at the scripture. Paul argued with them from the scripture. They argued back and forth with Paul about what the Bible actually said. They were relying on their own faulty interpretation of the scripture and not heeding the authority of the representative of the church that Christ left. Now, the Bereans were more noble because they gave Paul a fair hearing. They listened to him. And they looked at the scriptures and they said, yeah, this what he's saying could make sense from what's in the Bible. They weren't using the Bible to discredit Paul like they were in Thessalonica. The Jews in Thessalonica would be much more like Sola Scriptura Protestants than the Jews in Berea. So the Protestants are trying to imprint themselves on the wrong group here. So that's all I have for you today. Thank you so very much for joining me. If you like this video, please hit the like button, share it with your friends, share it in your social media groups. This will be the last time that I do a Jeff Durbin response video in a row. We're caught up now. So I will do part five when part five is released next week. And we'll have something different for you tomorrow. So once again, if you like this video, hit the like button. Share with your friends, share it in your social media groups. If you're not already subscribed, please hit the subscribe button. Please share my channel around. Let's grow my ministry and see how many people we can reach. And make sure you make sweet, sweet love to that notification bell so you never miss when I upload a new video. Thank you, everybody, for joining me, and have a nice day.